Hi there, I'm Alex Tantos. I'm a computational linguist and I use data analytic methods for exploring language phenomena here at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki in Greece. I've been playing with Julia these last couple of weeks and I think I'm on my way of using it more regularly from now on. I've been using R for my projects and recently I was made aware of Julia's advantages for scientific computing by some colleagues. And there are many things said for Julia's advantages. For instance, their practitioners claim that Julia offers a decent solution to the so-called two-language problem, the problem where you have one language for the prototyping, meaning the language where you can easily prepare your code for small-scale problems or for testing ideas. And these are languages such as Python or R. But when you want to scale up, you would need to transfer your code to a second language, such as C, for performance reasons. And in these languages, such as C, there is a slight bigger complexity in preparing your code, but the cost of that is balanced out by the big gain in performance. For more details, I refer you to some of the numerous resources available at Julia's official site, that explain in detail what I just mentioned about the two-language problem, as well as other Julia's features. The purpose of this video is to share some of the experience I gained these last couple of weeks as a newcomer to Julia, based on a couple of concrete, almost repetitive tasks that I have to complete for my analysis. And such a very common task is to fit a regression model to my data. A couple of words on the setting I'm using for running Julia code. I have Julia 1.2 installed on my machine, and this means that the code follows the big changes adopted after the release of version 1.0. And as far as I understand, the release of Julia 1.0 brought big changes to the language. The most important of which, I think, is the transfer of most of the packages that until then were included in the core of Julia to the standard library. And that means that they need to be loaded separately after you activate Julia and when you need to use their functionality. Although there are several options for running Julia code, the most popular of which, as far as I know, is the Atom-based Juno platform, which for some reason was too slow for me to follow when I tested it. I'm not sure why this happens, probably due to Atom, and other people who have had the same experience with me speculate about the reasons why this happens, and there is a live discussion on forums. If you have a good idea as to why this happens and how to fix it, please go ahead and throw a comment on the comments section below. I hope it gets better in the future, and then I will definitely give it a try again. Until then, I use Sublime Text 3 in combination with two plugins, the Terminus package that brings a terminal within Sublime Text, and the SendCode package that allows me to run code directly from a separate window to Terminus, as you will see in a minute. So let's go ahead and create a simple linear regression model with Julia, and that means that there will be one numeric dependent or outcome or response variable, these terms are used interchangeably in my field, that is regressed on a single numeric independent or predictor variable. A short note here is that Julia is notorious for performing fast numeric computations, but it only starts to shine when much more complex tasks are asked from it, rather than estimating a simple linear regression model. So although it may be an overkill for building such a simple model, this will be a good starting point of comparison with other, more mature languages such as R. One last side note is that this video is not about the statistical aspects of regression analysis. There are plenty of resources out there that explain all the math details related to regression. That is why I also skip the otherwise necessary stage of regression analysis that includes the descriptive exploration of all the relevant variables for tracing potential outliers or missing values that would suggest some further manipulation of the data. The first thing to know when programming in Julia is that you need to think of the packages you need to load in order to complete most of the tasks. In our case, the first package you need to use is GLM, that stands for Generalized Linear Modeling. In order to install any external Julia package, such as GLM, and by external package I mean any package that does not belong to the standard library, you simply enter the question mark that allows you to access the functionality of Julia's standard package manager, and then you simply write add followed by the name of the package you would like to install. I already installed GLM, and that is why I'm not doing it now. And now, assuming you have GLM installed, you simply need to load the functionality of the package to your workspace. For loading its functions in the namespace, you simply use the using statement followed by the name of the package. So here I write using GLM. For running the code, I put the cursor on the same line of the code on my GL file, script file, and press Command Enter for Mac, or I guess Control Enter if you work on Windows. As you will discover on your own, the first time you import a package to Julia, it takes some time, but then the loading of any function of the loaded package is done pretty fast. Next step is to think of the type of rectangular structure that I could store and access my data in Julia, and then use them for the modeling stage. And since I'm still used to R data frames, I would be inclined to use a data type that resembles R data frames. And since Julia has been trying to attract R users and to convince people like me to use it, well, guess what? There is a package called DataFrames that allows you to work with data frames. And these have been very pleasant news to me, to be honest, for smooth transitioning while learning Julia. So this means that one needs to install DataFrames first by using the Julia's package manager, as I just mentioned. And then I need to import its functionality with a using statement into my workspace, as I did with GLM. And now we're set to go. The dataset I'm going to use is a sample of the Greek Learner corpus, abbreviated as GLC. GLC is a corpus of second language learners of Greek. And for more information on GLC, go and have a look at the link below. Briefly, it contains sampled real-world data collected from 100 students of Greek as a second language. These are the test scores of these students on listening, reading, writing, and speaking tasks in Greek. That means that the data columns include four numeric variables. Okay, so far with GLC. In order to import the GLC data into Julia's workspace, I need to use the CSV package, since the GLC sample is stored in a CSV file. As with the previous packages, I simply use the using statement, and the next step is to use its csv.read function for importing the data into Julia and translate it into a data frame. Notice that as it's mentioned in the documentation, the embedded download function I use here may download data from any URL as long as you have either fetch, wget, or curl installed on your machine. These are well-known file transfer tools that you need to have in order for the download function to work. So, if this line of code doesn't work for you when you first use it, this might be the reason why. And if you install one of these programs, the problem is solved and you're ready to go. If you don't want to install any of these programs to your machine, an easy fix would be to simply go to my GitHub account in the link you see within the parentheses, where the CSV file lives, and you can manually download it. Then you can use the local copy directly with the csv.read function by providing the path to the file as the first argument of the function csv.read. So, now let's assume that you stored the CSV file's content into a data frame assigned to the variable called glc_test4. As you can see from the output, there are two problems. The first is that the colons are of type string. And the reason why this happens is that when importing a CSV file prepared within or opened with and saved in Microsoft Excel, sometimes the numbers are converted into strings. What you need to do is to convert them back into floating point numbers. The second is that if you live in Europe and specifically to a country where the decimals are usually denoted with commas instead of dots, you need to take care of that since decimals should have dots as their decimal separator. So for handling these two issues, namely for replacing the commas by dots in order to work undistracted with the regression functions later, and to also convert the strings into floating point numbers, I prepared two functions here, since this seems to be a repetitive task that I'm going to meet again and again, and that's actually the reason why you prepare functions in the first place. The comma underscore rep function is relevant to the replacement of commas by dots, and the convert underscore str underscore float 64 function for converting strings to floats. Then I map the functions to the colons of the data frame within a for loop, as you can see here. I know that this may not be the most efficient way of writing code in Julia, and I also suspect that the performance advantage of Julia may partly depend on the coding style. So if you're a more experienced user than me, and I know that there are plenty such users out there, don't hesitate to send me a comment suggesting improvements on the code. It would be greatly appreciated. Now, in R, you have many options for traversing through colons of a data frame, either with the apply family of functions or with tools provided by external packages, such as dplyr. And to be honest, I had to search a bit in order to be able to accomplish this pretty easy task in Julia. Well, I hope that in the near future, the documentation improves, and that the toolset for doing these daily tasks with Julia will increase. Now, the DataFrame GLC underscore test 4 is in the right form, and I can prepare my linear regression model. Creating a linear regression model is almost identical to R's way of doing it, namely by using the LM function. The only main difference in Julia is the formula macro. The formula macro takes care of the parsing of the code around the tilde sign that represents the model setting, whereby the variable on the left of the tilde represents the dependent variable, and the variable on the right of the tilde sign represents the independent variable. Okay, GLC underscore OLS is our model object. As you can see in the output, most of the information provided here is identical to the output of the summary function applied on the model object created by R's LM function. As you can see, you get the coefficient estimates that represent the intercept and the fixed effect of the independent variable, their standard errors, the p-value that indicates the significant difference from the zero intercept and slope correspondingly, or the absence of such a significant difference. There are a couple of differences that you may have also noticed. For instance, Julia's LM output includes numbers with greater accuracy than the ones in R's summary function, although this does not make much of a difference in terms of interpreting the results in our simple model here. You also get for free the 95 confidence intervals of the model's coefficients in Julia's LM output. On the other hand, in R's summary output, you get by default the R-squared index and the p-value of the partial f-test for comparing the current model with the null model, namely the model that does not take under consideration any information from other variables and is basically identical to the mean of the response variable. Let's go and grab this information. And in order to obtain the R-squared index, the GLM package includes the R2 function that is applied on the model object, here the GLC underscore OLS object. Our model explains around 21% of the variance in the listening test scores based on the information from the reading test scores. So not much has been explained based on a single predictor, as you can see. Now, let's try to replicate the partial f-test included in R summary output that allows to compare the two models, GLC underscore OLS and the null model. First thing to do is to create the null model, the one in the formula macro, simply means that there is nothing else to consider rather than the intercept, which is identical in the null model case to the mean of the response variable. And for comparing these two models, Julia's ftest function takes as its arguments the two models. Notice that you need to access the field model of the model object. What the output says is that by including the GLC underscore part 2 variable with the reading test scores to the null model, the increase in explanatory power of the enhanced model is statistically significant, which is expected in our case. So the null model doesn't include information about any other variable. Coming back to the model field of the model object, in order to access the fields that a model object contains, you can use the field names function. The field names function takes the data type of the model object as its argument, not the model object itself, but the data type. And in our case, the data type is the table regression model from the stats models package. And now, as you can see, the field names are the model matrix MM, and the model frame MF. That's it for now. I welcome any comment on the content or any correction on what I said throughout the video. I will make the Julia code file presented in this video available in GitHub, so you can go and fetch the link from the video description below. I plan to upload more videos on Julia as I'm making my way through learning the language, mainly videos on various subjects that I come across every day when I'm using R for my projects. And if you like the content, make sure to subscribe in order to get notification when new videos are released.